Thank you, Dottie. It's beautiful. Good morning.
Good morning.
Ah, I love it. Welcome to worship at De Leon First United Methodist Church, Sunday morning worship. It's good to see people here in this room. It's good to see you all out there online, Facebook Live. Welcome to you all. My name is John Woodard, and I am very blessed to be the pastor here and at Morton Chapel. And it's just good to be here with you all in God's house and God's presence. This is the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. We're still in a season of where our liturgical color is green. And my announcement this morning is that I am glad to see people in this room worshiping God like we're supposed to, almost. All of you who have come and are adhering to the guidelines, thank you, thank you, thank you, and thank y'all. And those of you who feel like you shouldn't be here, I appreciate you too. I appreciate you worshiping with us online as well. So as we continue our worship service this morning, let us stand and we're going to have our greeting. Wave to each other. Yeah. Hey, y'all, wave to our team, wave to the camera. Hi, y'all out there, absolutely. And as we come back around, let us continue worship with our call to worship. Whether you arrived here first thing this morning or came in as the service was beginning, God bids you joyful welcome. Thank you. You are precious in God's sight, a delight in God's presence. Know that God's compassionate love is poured over you this day. Hallelujah. Amen. Let us continue to stand as we sing our first hymn this morning from the Faith We Sing book, Give Thanks. You may have heard the choir sing this a time or two. Now it's our turn. Wonderful. Thank you, Leslie. Thank you, Dottie. Now, as we continue to stand, let us recite our affirmation of faith this morning, a statement of faith of the United Church of Canada. There are bulletins on the back of the pews, along with a mask if you need one. If you haven't got one of these great ones that Belinda made us, you may take that with you. Use the cloth ones if you'd like. Well, here we go. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated if you would like.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We have a little shift in the lineup this morning. Debbie and Kevin hopefully are enjoying a vacation in Colorado.
Amen.
Which they deserve greatly. And if you're watching, we say have a good time, guys.
Absolutely.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh,
I haven't ran this clicker before, so if you find I'm behind on the words or something, Cliff is actually helping me back up to keep me on track. So a big kudos to Clifford, who's actually helping me keep on track. Yeah, so that, so everything will run a little bit smoother. But thank you again.
We're loading.
All right.
Cliff, could you change the beginning? Thank you. It's also been written by Paul as well, In My Heart. And just two songs that have really been going good. Thank you, Paul, for that. So let's bow our heads and for a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so blessed to be here today and to be able to worship in person and to see each other and to see each other's eyes and actions and just to know and feel your presence, Heavenly Father. We pray for those that are not able to come and those that that need healing, dear Heavenly Father, that have been stricken by this disease, and that, dear Heavenly Father, that you will get them through this and know that they'll come through it courageously, dear Heavenly Father. We ask that you also watch over each and every one of us here, each family member, watch over our community and city, state, and nation, dear Heavenly Father, dear God. We're just going through so many trials and so many things that are just not going in your name. If we just let you come into our heart and love each other, dear Heavenly Father, we would not have these problems, dear Heavenly Father. So we need to do your work. And the fields are white and ready for the harvest. We just need to be the hands and the feet to go out into the world and to spread your love like no other time before. Because we are a nation that's been split in so many ways. We are a nation that needs to get back to the basics of who you are, dear Heavenly Father, and what you stand for love, and what you have given us so incredible much through your Son, Jesus Christ. Again, prayers for all the ones that are here today. Help us, dear Heavenly Father, to walk in your will. In God's name we pray. And everyone said, amen.
Amen. Happy birthday, Susie.
With all of my heart and only you.
Good morning once again. Thank you all. That was great. Absolutely wonderful. Kevin and Debbie would be proud. Absolutely. I do hope they're watching, but I wouldn't blame them if they're not. This is our time of joys and concerns. I want to start off as we often do, and that is celebrating with the folks that are having birthdays this week or even today, as Paul has already mentioned, because today is Susie Two Fagan's birthday. Woohoo! And also Brooke Golden's birthday. Later in the week, we have Brendan James and Grace Everhart on the 21st tomorrow. And then the twins, Kylie and Cambry Simpson, on the 23rd. And on the 25th, Glenda Weaver is celebrating her birthday. And also, and I know they're watching, I've already seen them on the comments and stuff, Philip and Valinda Salazar celebrating their anniversary on the 23rd. So when you see these folks, if you do, wish them a happy day during the week. And let us sing happy birthday to Susie too today, because I know she would be here if she could. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Susie, too. Happy birthday to you. And many more. That's right. We got her many, many more in there. Happy birthday, Susie, and all of you that we mentioned. So, moving on. I know that many of you have concerns and joys on your hearts and minds, and if you want to share those this morning, I'd love to hear them. I've got one. I want us to continue to pray for Michelle Simpson and her family on the passing of her mom, Mrs. Price. Keep them in your prayers. Any others this morning? I wondered. Okay, still need one. Absolutely. And prayers? Oh, repeat? Oh, okay. That was Ross Searles. He was telling us that Marion is in Juarez doing her thing down there with the kids, which is wonderful. And they thought they had a donor for his son-in-law, right? And who's needing a kidney. They thought they had a donor, but there was a complication there, and that didn't work out. So we're still needing one. So there's an email that's been out with the information on to be tested to see if you could be a donor for their son-in-law. So that's great. Thank you, Ross, for all of that. All right. Any others this morning? Kind of got to get back into the swing. Yes, Sandra. All right, Brooklyn, happy birthday. All right, yes, Kimberly. It's okay, it's all right. Okay, yes. That was Kimberly, and she was wanting us to pray for the time when they can meet, the youth can meet in person again. And I think we could start thinking about that pretty soon. And so where's Greg? Oh, you have some more stuff to say about the youth? Thank you guys for being here, by the way, once again. Great to see you. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, here we go. Whoa.
I'm here. Okay, good. Oh, no. Yes. Yeah, a lot of things that's been going on. I guess we had the charge conference going on earlier. And we actually had a representative from CCYM actually get to speak before the conference as well. And they were speaking in behalf of the organization and how we run it through the conference area, basically. And unfortunately, the proposal that they sent in to try to keep it running close to the way we had it before, I don't think it got enough votes to support it. So even though that didn't go through, there's still going to be some kind of presence with CCYM because there's so many volunteers, so many people that are willing to keep it going. So if it's not in the conference, we will have support one way or another to keep our CCYM going because it's just been such a blessing, you know, to the conference, to the kids, to be able to meet with each other, and to throughout the, you know, the whole conference area, you know, we get to know so many more people that way and get a kind of a broader experience because each one of these kids right here have been on mission trips and can tell you what they have gone through and what they've learned and just that's another reason they're here today because it just fills you up with the spirit and it just gets you charged up and ready to go that they want more. So our kids want more. They want more than what, you know, as much as we can give them because, you know, there's a hunger out there for our kids. And if we can continue to support that in one way or another, you know, our youth is going to grow, you know, and it's something that we need to have, you know, for our church. You know, that's the livelihood and that's the future of our church here as well. So that is something that that we want to continue and it will continue in one way or another, of course, because of God's help. So again, I just wanted to update y'all on that. And again, thank you for the youth that are here today. And again, their support shows here that they're hungry for, you know, to getting back together and getting to know one another and other kids in the conference as well.
So, and more Jesus.
Yes.
That's
more
right.
More Jesus. Thank you again.
All right. Thank you, Greg. I'm glad that Greg brought that up because yesterday I spent most of the day at annual conference in my study at the Parsonage. Started at 10 and ended, 5:30 or 6. And most of the time, most of the discussion that was going on in the proceedings had to do with what Greg was talking about. There is going to be a restructuring in our Central Texas Conference. We have 5 districts now. That's going down to 3. All kind of different changes going on. We will be combined with the North District in our conference, all kinds of things like that. And in that process, there were some changes made with CCYM and CTCYM and the funding, and it was kind of brought down from a conference level to the district level. And what I saw across the board were lots of people concerned about the youth in our conference and how they can we can allow them to go on more trips, continue to do winter thing. Yes, at Glen Lake, and Glen Lake is still going to be funded and all of that, so that's all good. But what I'm getting to is that there's a good chance when this boils down to a district organization for the youth and getting their activities together, we're going to be asking for y'all's help. So just be open to that, whatever it may be, and volunteer maybe or some donations, whatever. Prayers for sure. So just be in prayer for our youth like they've been saying and Greg said so well. So I was pleased with all the care across the board, conference-wise, district-wise, of the folks in our conference for our youth. So thank you, Greg. Any others concerns or joys that we want to lift up this morning? If not, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear God, it was a great thing to have your presence with us at annual conference yesterday, albeit spread all across the state. And I even saw a woman that was attending from Africa that was wanting to vote on the particular things, and she was trying to get that all worked out. Lord, you're everywhere, and you're there before we get there, and that's the glory of you, one of the many glories. Dear Lord, we do care about our youth, not just our own personal ones like those that are here today, and bless them, Lord, but also all across our conference, all the conferences, Lord, and all the faiths. We care for our children and our youth, and we want them to grow and follow you along the way, and know that serving you means serving others, and ours here today, Lord, know that so well, and they just want to get out and do more of that. Lord, please lead us to that time when that can happen. Dear Lord, I want to thank you for this glorious day that you've made for us. Thank you again for the rain that we've had. Lord, be with the south border of our country, the south coast. Once again, we have hurricanes aimed at Texas, and it might turn to Louisiana once again. And those states down there, Louisiana, Alabama, Mississippi, Florida, still not even getting close to building back from Sally, Lord. And so, dear Lord, be with those as they prepare once again for another. Also, be with all of those that have already been affected by all the wildfires in our western states, even down to New Mexico. Lord, be with all of them. And be with those firefighters, Lord. Just let your be with them in each of those dangerous situations, and let them know that you are there. Lord, I pray for rain in that region. I think it's coming, Lord. Please bring it, and so that that'll help that situation. Lord, we thank you for those that are here in this room and those that are worshiping with us, worshiping you in your holy name. And Lord, at this time, let us once again go to that very special prayer that your son Jesus taught the first disciples. He told them as he saw them struggling, when you pray, and he's telling us the same thing, pray in this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right, children. Hope the children are watching. If not, come get them. Bring them to the device, the phone, the laptop, whatever. Because I want to talk to you kids about what we're talking about later on from the Bible story. So, I hope, maybe some of y'all have already been doing what we older folks call chores at home. Doing work to help your mom and dad, your grandmoms, aunts, and uncles. Taking out the trash, making your beds, that kind of thing. Those are little jobs. And that's what we're kind of talking about in the Bible here in a few minutes. Jesus is talking about people needing jobs, and then people that have work to do that they need people to do that work. So one of these days, y'all are all going to have a job to do, and you'll make money at it and all of that. So you might see, I know this is still small, but this is a sign, and it says job wanted. And there's even special places in the newspaper where you can put that you want a job and this is what you'd like to do and that kind of thing. And so a job, let's think about a job that you might want to do. How about ice cream tester? Yeah, that'd be a good job, I think. But, you know, if you think about it, it's more than just eating all the ice cream that you want. You have to have some skills, I would think. You have to have a developed sense of taste so that you can tell the difference between the different types of ice cream. And you have to be honest, and some of your friends might be the ones making the ice cream, and you might have to tell them, well, yours is close, but just not quite there. So, you know, keep working on it, that kind of thing. So, jobs are kind of complicated, but we still need them. So you might want a job someday. Well, somebody will put this sign up then. This says, help wanted. These are the people looking for people that need jobs. They need help. They've got something they need done, and they need people to help them do it. Well, Jesus is kind of like that. He has things that we need to do that he needs us to do for him. We've been singing about it. We've been talking about it. Going to talk about it a little more. But what does Jesus need us to do? What jobs could we do for Jesus? Well, we could be kind to each other. We could have peace among each other. We can love our brothers and sisters, cousins, our friends at school, church. There's lots of things that Jesus has for us to do. And I know that you can do them. Those are good jobs to do. So that's what I've got this morning. Let's sing our song, Jesus Loves Me. Here we go. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Even me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Bye, guys. See you next week. Take care. Do your jobs. All right. At this time, another very special part of our worship is when, these days, when we consider our gifts, our tithes, and offering. And by tithes, I mean that portion of our funds that we bring in that are owed back to God. Goes back to Old Testament teaching. This is a very special part of worship, because from these gifts, these donations, our church, our conference, our district can continue to be working with, like the children, like the youth, the programs, all these things. Can continue to do those things. And our church, Morton Chapel folks, do so much in the community, and it's because of you and your gifts. So as we consider those times, and everybody knows by now that for a while we still can't pass the plate, unfortunately, and that kind of thing. We have a plate and a basket set up in the foyer for folks to put in their gifts when they come or when they leave. So as we consider our gifts this morning, let us pray. Dear Lord, we do come before you giving thanks for all that you have given us. This opportunity to be in this room, Lord, is one of those great gifts. Lord, and we thank you for the gift of those who are still at home, being safe. They're taking their own perspective on this, and that is fine too. Dear Lord, and they continue to give as well, and that's a wonderful thing. Dear Lord, please accept the gifts that we give today. We know that you can use them. You can multiply them so that they are spread out and do so much work, bringing your will and your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Told the folks at Morton Chapel this morning that we were doing worship like we do there, prayer, prayer, prayer. and I like it there and I like it here. So as we prepare to enter into God's written word this morning, let us pray. Dear Lord, this is a mysterious library of books in this collection. Wonderful stories. One of the best we're going to read and study this morning. Dear Lord, let each of us find the lesson for ourselves in these words. In Jesus' name, amen. This is the word, written word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God, indeed. So Bishop Will Willimon tells about a time when he did a sermon on this text in the glorious chapel of Duke University. And he writes about that experience. He says, "She came up to me at the end of the service saying, 'I was really troubled by the service today.'" Because of the words that you said about that story you told. And I'm going to tell that story right now. It is in Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. Here's that reading. "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyards. After he agreed with the workers to pay them a denarian, he sent them into his vineyards. And then he went out around 9 in the morning and saw others standing around the marketplace doing nothing. He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard and I'll pay you whatever is right.' And they went. Again around noon, and then at 3 in the afternoon, he did the same thing. Around 5 in the afternoon, he went and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you just standing around here doing nothing all day long?' 'Because nobody has hired us,' they replied. He responded, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the workers and give them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and moving on finally to the first.' And when those who were hired at 5 in the afternoon came, each one received a denarian. Now when those hired first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received a denarian. When they received it, they grumbled against the landowner. 'These who were hired last worked 1 hour, and they received the same pay as we did, even though we had to work the whole day in the hot sun.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I did you no wrong. Didn't I agree to pay you a denarian? Take what belongs to you and go. I want to give to this one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with what belongs to me? Or are you resentful because I'm generous? So those who are last will be first, and those who are first will be last.'" So that's the story that this young lady is upset about. And she said, and she came before him, and she's wearing a blue Duke usher's robe. She had been a part of the service. And she said, "Where do you get these stories that you tell in your talk?" "Stories? Well, I guess from when I was growing up in South Carolina, he said. Well, I was really bothered by that one today. I just don't think that's any way to treat people. I mean, if you work longer than other people, then you should get paid more. Wait a minute, I said, that's not my story. That comes from Matthew. Matthew, she asked. It's in the Bible. Why are you ushering here, I asked. Well, that tall guy over there, I'm dating him, and he needed somebody to usher today, so he called me, and here I am. So we'll hear the rest of that conversation in a little bit. But we get it, don't we? What she was talking about. It wasn't fair. In our culture, like the young lady said, our culture has taught us that if you work more, you deserve more. Money. So the kingdom of heaven is messed up. You know how I don't like to just have a block of scripture dumped in our laps. So, earlier, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? That's the first verse of chapter 18, when Jesus tells us that unless we become like the little children, then we will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Jesus continually tried to get the disciples to grasp the idea of the kingdom of heaven, which, let's face it, it's not easy to get across, especially when he uses a story that kind of upsets us to demonstrate his point. But he does use things that the disciples were familiar with. They had heard about them. Vineyards, grapes that needed harvesting, men looking for work. So the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner going into the marketplace looking for workers for his vineyards. I kind of thought it would be more than that, didn't you? Well, it gets worse. He goes back and gets workers at different times of the day until finally there is only 1 hour of work left. And when he gets these last ones, and when it comes time for them to receive their pay, they all receive the same amount that the very first ones were promised. And to make matters worse, Jesus had the manager pay the ones that had just worked an hour, paid them first. So the ones that had worked all day could see what they were being paid. I think Jesus likes to use our own human nature on us. Because guess what? The ones that worked all day were mad because they received the same pay, even though it was what they agreed on, as the ones that just worked an hour. Was it fair? No. Wasn't. Not the way we see it. And that's really the whole point, the way we see it. Remember in the parable at the end when they're grumbling about how they've been treated? The landowner actually tries to reason with them, tried to convince them that they had not been wronged. But no, Jesus had to tell the story from the back of the line so that the things would all get stirred up. The landowner finally says, "Don't I have the right to do what I want with what belongs to me? Or are you resentful because I'm generous?" That last little question, when it is rendered literally as it is in the King James Version, comes out. Is your eye evil because I'm generous? I just love that. The problem is not with the landowner's generosity, but with our eyesight, our angle of vision. You know, I've spoken of my professor, Dr. Namsoon Kong's understanding of the Jesus gaze, that is, looking at everything in life through Jesus' eyes. I think that fits well here. If we can just wait and watch long enough, sometimes one of the ways we come to know the goodness of God is when we see it being experienced through others. This is what happened in the story. We can see the goodness of God more clearly when it is experienced in the lives of others, quite simply because they are other than us. The back of the line offers us this perspective. You know, Jesus told another story that when we first read it, we probably thought, that isn't fair. That's messed up. That's the story of the prodigal son. The elder son in the story is enraged when the younger brother, who had squandered his inheritance, is welcomed home with unabashed lavishness by his father. It is not fair. It is not fair that the oldest son, who stayed home and did what he was supposed to do, does not get his just reward. It's messed up. And that is exactly what many people hear when they hear today's parable. How unjust of the landowner not to give those who labored all day in the hot sun their just reward. How unfair of the landowner to treat each of the laborers equally, despite the disproportionate hours that they worked. So, what is going on here then? We know that the landowner feels that he may allot what he wishes to whom he wishes. But does God feel that way? Does God act that way? Well, yeah, I think God does. It's difficult for us to imagine how it is it just doesn't matter what the next person does or doesn't do. God works with each of us equally. And that brings up another thing that bothers me. The landowner goes back all those times to get the workers. And every time, there are different ones there needing work. Well, if they needed it so badly, why weren't they there first thing in the morning? He even asked the last ones what they had been doing all day. Why hadn't he seen them the other times? Where had they been? What had they been doing? Sleeping in? When it comes right down to it, it didn't matter. It doesn't matter. Not only did he hire them, he paid them the same as the rest. God's grace is like that. What was it God said in the shack? I'm especially fond of this one. Meaning each and every one of us. Every man that the landowner encountered was offered work. As often is the case in this parable, we are invited and challenged to see ourselves in the story. The story reminds us that God is a lousy bookkeeper and invites us to transform our pride, envy, and selfishness into joy by admiring and celebrating God's astounding generosity. The parable calls for us to look at ourselves honestly and lovingly as God sees us. It invites us to turn from holding grudges because things did not go our way, to let go of the stuff of our lives that keeps us from being joy-filled and grateful people. When we read, those who were hired last worked 1 hour, and they received the same pay as we did, that same line in the King James Version says, these last have wrought but 1 hour, and thou hast made them equal unto us. Yes, that's right. As messed up as it sounds, that is exactly what happened. And I don't know about you, but this is good for me to hear. Just one example why this is good for me to hear. Sometimes when I hear really good guitarists play, like our Breath of Life guitarist, I want to take my old guitar and turn it into a coffee table. Thankfully, God just doesn't see it that way. In our parable, Jesus presents to the disciples, to us, to the church, a new reality. He offers a vision of the alternative household of God's empire. And if we keep that alternative vision in our hearts and minds and study on it just a bit, we may be able to imagine that the kingdom of heaven may not be so messed up after all. Disciples who accept the message of the gospel must undertake the values of the kingdom of heaven, which tend to seriously contradict the values of the dominant society. In this case, the core values presented by the parable are generosity, mercy, and love. And to allow us to see that, Jesus does have a way of getting our attention. In the name of, Dr. Willimon and the young lady. So the next question that he asked her was, what is your religious background? Well, we went to church some when I was little, but I'm not anything right now. And he said, well, let me tell you something, just for your information. There is a sense in which you are the only person who got the story this morning. You found it offensive to your notion of justice, right? Outrageous, right? Well, just for your information, the man who told that story was murdered for telling it. You got it. It really is an offensive, outrageous story. You got it. Amen. In a moment, we'll be standing to sing our last hymn this morning. And as we consider that, I'd like to offer an invitation to anyone here that would like to join our church, that you could come and do that. Or you can get with me and we can make that happen in a different way. If you have something on your heart or mind that you need to share with me or another leader in the church, we can do that as well. So if you would please stand as we sing. Leslie. Absolutely. Thank you, Dottie. And now let us prepare for our benediction this morning. Let us pray. Dear God, we are here to do your work. Put us to doing it. Place us with those who need to know you. Let us give to the need without caring who, because when we give to the need, we are giving to you. Amen. Thank you for coming. All of you out there too, I love you all.